Ladies and gentlemen, the Brandon Tartikoff Legacy Awards presentation will begin in 5 minutes. Ladies and gentlemen, the Brandon Tartikoff Legacy Awards presentation is about to begin. Please turn your attention to the stage.
It's Billy Bush time.
You gotta sell the hands. Like when you're tapping like that.
Can we get some makeup for Billy on set, stat? We need some makeup.
Ray, get him. Get him, Ray.
He's in it to win it.
Yeah.
Ow, Jason. I bet my butt's higher than yours.
I got up for this. What is this?
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Brandon Tartikoff Legacy Award presentation, sponsored by Broadcasting and Cable, Multichannel News, NBC Universal, and RBC Royal Bank of Canada. Please welcome the host of Access Hollywood and co-host of Access Hollywood Live, Billy Bush.
Thank you. Oh, please. Thank you very much. Are we on? We're on. Thank you very much. It's great to be in this room, and we got a big night for you, and it's going to be nice and quick, and as Dick Ebersol says, tight. We'll keep it tight. I've had a beautiful day today here at the Fontainebleau. Thanks to the hotel for taking care of us. I did my live show out at the pool, had Katie Couric and Charlie Sheen. Forget, you just laugh when you say the name, Charlie Sheen. One is cleared in every state, the other's wanted in every state. You should have seen the look on Katie's face as Charlie was approaching her. She's in the middle of her live shot with me. He's walking right in, and it's clear that he's coming into the shot, and he's going to kiss her on the cheek. He comes in and kissed me instead. Still recovering from it. We have got a great night tonight. Tonight's honorees represent broadcasters, creators, innovators, people that keep television at its tops, who bring content into viewers' living rooms, and we've got the best of the best here tonight. So I want to introduce first one of our sponsors tonight, and that is from Broadcasting and Cable, Vice President and Group Publisher, Lewis Hillison. Lewis.
Thank you very much, Billy, and thank you all for attending. If Dick Ebersol says keep it tight, I will keep it very tight. So thank you all. BNC is proud to sponsor these awards again, and it's a great honor for us. Congratulations to all of the honorees this year. Very well deserving, and congratulations to Rick and his team on a wonderful conference. That's it. Have a great evening, and back to Billy.
Wow. This is unbelievable. It's record time. With no further ado, we just mentioned Rick Feldman, the president and CEO of NATPE. Rick, you got your work cut out for you, Rick.
I'm not going to sing. And Dick, it's not going to be that tight. So, first of all, thank you, Billy and Lewis, and let me be the third person to welcome you all to this event. As you know, this is our ninth yearly remembrance of Brandon's birthday, which every year is in January. And also this year, it's also a special year because it was announced this week in a deal between Lilly and George Lucas and USC that about 4,000 of Brandon's items from about 1979 to 1992 are going to be given to the USC School of Cinematic Arts. So Lilly, mazel tov, congratulations, it's a wonderful thing. She's been working on that for a while, and it's great that it goes to USC. So as time passes, I feel even better about having these awards because our business needs to be reminded that creative people and ideas need to be nurtured, that in the pursuit of elite programming, risks have to be taken, and that copycat programming has risks of its own. Brandon would be enjoying all of the new distribution platforms because they would be giving him even more areas in which to play. He would know and understand that telling stories and developing breakthrough characters is the key to success on any screen. I think it's great that these awards celebrate him. And by the way, it's been 15 years, believe it or not. That's how fast time flies. His work and his memory, and I also think that he'd be very proud of the four honorees we are recognizing tonight. From broadcast executives to program creators, they represent a national and international array of truly talented thinkers and doers. To Brandon, content really was king. And these very well-respected professionals embrace his vision of employing creative new ways to monetize great content. And while I'm on the subject of money, I would like to thank Lewis for his support, also David Bank from RBC, and Joe Schlosser and Ted Harbert, who work with us from NBC Universal. Without their support, this doesn't happen, so it's really appreciated for this wonderful event. I also want to extend my thanks to Phil Guerin, our presenters, and our distinguished honorees, whom you're about to meet. But most of all, I want to thank the wonderful woman I now bring to the stage, Lily Tartikoff Carrots. Lily.
Making your way in the world today takes everything you've got. Taking a break from all your worries.
Good evening, and thank you for joining us at the 9th Annual Brandon Tartikoff Legacy Awards. Brandon Tartikoff loved to talk television, where it was hitting the mark and where it wasn't, how to push the bar to the next level and ultimately find the magic. This is why he loved NATPE. He was searching for people just like him, those with vision and fueled with fresh inspiration. He did his best work surrounded by people who were absolutely original. Tonight's recipients of the 2012 Brandon Tartikoff Legacy Awards embody these qualities. Brandon used to say, "The audience doesn't know what it wants until you give it to them." Cecile Frot-Coutaz had the courage to do just that. She is the force behind the phenomenon of American Idol and a world-class team builder running 400 hours of programming at Fremantle Media North America. In short, she is everything a visionary television producer should be. Brandon's number one rule for programming was to create engaging characters, put them into identifiable situations, and watch the audience fall in love. That is exactly what Fernando Gaitán did, and boy, did he nail it. The character of Ugly Betty is so true that she charms audiences in over 21 versions across the globe. And for this and his many other achievements at Columbia's RCN TV, he is deservedly called a Latin American creative icon. Because of the intense ratings game, Brandon worried that the intelligent adult drama would become an endangered species, and that its brilliant writers would be forced out of the TV universe, or worse, have to write heart-to-heart for the 21st century. Matthew Weiner, it would have driven Brandon crazy that you did not write Mad Men for NBC. You have created the kind of show that had him running to his office every morning, but let me assure you, he would have made sure that your next show was for his network. It is impossible to pick just one of Brandon's benchmarks to describe Dennis Swanson's career. He is living proof of so many. He has an eagle eye for talent, a brilliant imagination for programming, a finger on the pulse of the audience, and can we talk bottom line? The fact that Brandon has such admiration for Dennis makes this award so special. And on a personal note, when Dennis was at NBC, he championed my Revlon Run Walks, which helped to deliver the first ever non-toxic treatment for breast cancer. He is my hero, too. It is. Thank you. It is such an honor to stand before you all. You all represent the family of television. It always hurts that he can't be here to experience this privilege. It would be so important to Brandon to thank the people that support NATPE. He would thank Broadcasting and Cable, Multi-Channel News, Royal Bank of Canada, and our friends at NBC Universal. We all know he loved being the center of their attention. And finally, he would be so touched that his friend at NATPE, Rick Feldman, his friend who shared both his loves, TV and baseball, insisted on keeping his vision alive. I thank you all so much, and here's the film.
Imagine, if you will, a 7-year-old boy sitting nose to screen in front of a 7-inch Dumont television set. He begins to fantasize that if he tried hard, he could shrink to a tiny size and crawl inside the set. Then he could live and breathe television from the inside all day. That boy got his wish.
Since 2004, the Brandon Tartikoff Legacy Award has recognized the most innovative leaders and artistic visionaries in television. They are men and women who have shaped the business, inspired their colleagues, and left an indelible mark on our culture.
It's a singular honor. It's really unlike anything else.
The prestige of the Brandon Tartikoff Legacy Award comes from the inspirational life of its namesake and from the caliber of its distinguished honorees.
He, of course, had an imagination. He had a passion. He was a great leader.
Collectively, their creative vision continues to define what is popular and what is possible in a business that changes every day.
He contributed so much to so many audiences out there.
Brandon was the epitome of class and competition, and everyone who's come since him has wanted to emulate Brandon Tartikoff. There's never been anyone in the business like him.
Tonight's Legacy Award recipients embody Brandon's spirit and are tremendous examples of his passion, vision, and leadership.
He truly was a man that loved television. I'll never forget the one thing he said, which was 90% of the sale in the room to him was the passion.
This year's honorees truly have made a lasting contribution to the legacy of our craft.
The goal is to be able to say, 10 years' time, I helped bring those shows to life. And, you know, they made people's life a little bit better, because when they come home at night after a hard day's work, they tuned in and they laughed or they cried and they escaped for a little bit. That's what we do. We create fantasy and we create escapism.
You have to take some risks. What was it that made Brandon great? Well, he went to a network that was failing and he fixed it. But don't look for the easy mark, look for the tough one. Anything you ever get easy, you don't really appreciate, but when you get it, when you really applied yourself and it's been difficult, you have a greater appreciation for it.
I wanted to say, loud enough for the whole world to hear, Dennis, I thank you.
I'm very proud to be in the company of the people who have won this award. And I'm very proud to be in the television business right now. I think that we have been afforded a luxury to really tell deep stories with earned endings. I look around at what people are doing and the way it's being done, and I'm very proud to be part of this whole thing at this moment in time. It is a special time.
Desde que llegué a televisión y la conocí, he dicho que me quiero quedar y quiero que me entierren con ella. Lo que más me encanta de este premio es que me lo dan estando en Colombia, habiendo producido todo lo que he producido desde el país, con todas las dificultades que hemos tenido en Colombia para generar contenidos.
NATPE takes great pride in recognizing this year's honorees and adding their names to an exclusive list representing some of the finest talents in the history of television. Tonight, we celebrate Brandon's legacy. NATPE, in association with Broadcasting and Cable, Multi-Channel News, NBC Universal, and Royal Bank of Canada, proudly congratulates the 2012 Brandon Tartikoff Legacy Award recipients.
Okay, so about 3 months ago, my cell phone rings, and the voice on the other side says, please hold for Dick Ebersol. I went, oh God, what have I done? I'm banned from the Olympics, something's happened. And I get on the phone, and Dick comes to the line, and he says, I was just watching Access Hollywood Live, Billy. I said, really? That's great, thanks. And he said, I watched your interview with Linda Evans, and you listened. You listened really well. It was a good interview, I enjoyed it, good job listening. And that was it. And I said, okay, Dick, thanks. Thanks very much. That one phone call meant more to me than all of my Peabody's, Emmys, and Oscars combined. So, Dick, I thank you for that. And now we welcome Dick as he presents to NATPE Legacy honoree Dennis Swanson.
That phone call actually happened. I don't think Billy understands why it happened, though. As a senior advisor, as opposed to a chairman, you have time to watch morning television. Introducing Dennis is a real treat for me. There's so many aspects of Dennis, many you'll see in the film in a little while, but let's start with the fact that Dennis is that rare bird who's been a star at all four broadcasting companies. He's hit the grand slam. And the one thing I want to tell you is, you want to be the guy who gets him after he leaves somewhere, because that competitive nature accelerates as if it's on cocaine when he leaves someplace. As each succeeding place is seen, as Dennis is determined to move along. And I don't believe anybody's ever let Dennis go, but he's just determined that he's going to go, and he's going to get them on the way out the door. I think more than anything else, it's easy to think of Dennis as one thing. He's not. In my mind, he's the best station guy of our lifetimes. He's done it in the three toughest, biggest markets in this country. At our company, it's hard to believe, but NBC, up until 1996, 97, had never been number one once. It's almost inconceivable when you think for how long it was really just a two-station market, but it never could be number one until Dennis got there. But the other thing about Dennis that it's going to be touched on heavily in the film, but I want to emphasize it, he's a world-class programmer. I mean, he took a gal from Baltimore who was working on, I guess it was the Westinghouse PM magazine, brought her to Chicago, gave her her own talk show, and within a matter of a year or two, it was the sensation of daytime television in America. And when you really think about the ratings of Oprah, she would probably be number one in primetime about now as the broadcast ratings shrank more and more every year. He put Regis and Kathy Lee together, and his days as the head of ABC Sports, among other things, he was responsible for the resurgence of Monday Night Football. But you know, with all of those things, and I have to point out at the time that Dennis was at ABC Sports, I was running NBC Sports. With all those things that were going for Dennis, I actually and honestly was disinclined to like Dennis. Yes, he was my competitor. He was also the guy who had succeeded my mentor, Rune Arledge. But more than anything else, I mean, look at Dennis. I mean, when you look at Dennis and you don't really know him, you'd be disinclined to dislike him. He's a little, he can be a little bit gruff the first time you see him. He's a little bit big. He's like a bear. And along comes, believe it or not, the thing that was the catalyst 20 years ago that gave me this great friendship that I've enjoyed with Dennis for the last two decades was Brandon, indirectly. Brandon and his daughter Calla were in a horrific car accident at the end of or beginning of 1990. And I was here actually in Miami doing the Orange Bowl, and I immediately got on a plane and flew to Reno and was lucky enough in that terrible time to pass muster with my beloved Lily, and the only outsider allowed for weeks in the hospital. And I think I'd been there about 10 days, and this letter came, an ABC stationery, and I opened it up in the hotel next to the hospital, and it was a letter from Dennis. And the letter basically said, everyone is praying for the Tartikoff family right now, and we are so lucky that you're there representing all of us. And in that millisecond, I realized how wrong I'd been about Dennis. There were some other things in that letter that he had been through a similar thing with his son, Eric, who had been in a pretty devastating accident. But it just reached into my heart. And when I went back into New York, we saw each other and we became quickly friends. We did a lot of innovative business deals together. But most of all, I just realized that what I thought was that big mean bear was one of the best, softest, kindest human beings I'd ever met. And then to have it all then happen to me when I lost my son in a plane crash, same thing. The person who came time and time again, all the way up into the Berkshires to sit by my bed, was Dennis. And the person, the first time that I was carried out of the house anywhere after about more than a month, the person who came and stood by me in this long receiving line at a memorial service, and I was doped up to the gills, but the person who was there as my protector just to make sure nobody grabbed me or touched me the wrong way. And I've always thought that with all the other accomplishments that Dennis has had, the one thing that is undeniable is that his humanity may come in a big bear, but it's really a teddy bear. Dennis? No, your film. Your film.
Dennis Swanson started his broadcast career in the late 1950s at the University of Illinois television station, where he co-produced a weekly sports show. But it was his instinct for news in Los Angeles in 1978 that won him a Peabody Award. That got him promoted to station manager, where he saw the potential of a new syndicated show, The People's Court.
He loved the show, felt it was a lead into the 4 o'clock news, and he talked them into putting us on at 3:30 to 4 o'clock.
Wheel of Fortune was the next syndicated show to get the nod from Dennis.
It all began in Chicago when you became general manager at WLS, a news director doing the unconventional thing, taking news off. You went against all of the management and decided to put Wheel of Fortune on from a small, tiny company.
The next season, Dennis bought Jeopardy from King World, and lightning struck again. But his biggest triumph was his pick for the AM show in Chicago.
Dennis hired me, and I thought it was one of the bravest. It was such a courageous act at the time, because he stood to be so criticized by not only his peers, but, you know, by the city, who knew that I was going to work on television.
As president of the station division, Dennis hired Kathy Lee, paired her with Regis on WABC-TV, and another syndicated hit was created. Monday Night Football was next. Now at ABC Sports, Dennis made Al Michaels the primetime voice of the NFL.
You made some moves that took the guts of a burglar to make in terms of Monday Night Football. The headline of the Dallas Morning News said, "Can Monday Night Football be saved?" The network, Dennis, can thank you resoundingly for not only saving Monday Night Football, but making it the number one ranked show on the entire primetime lineup.
Dennis also got the NFL to expand its wildcard team so that ABC Sports would get playoff games every year. He and Dick Ebersol did the same thing with Major League Baseball, working with an owners committee to create wildcards and the present playoff formula. Swanson also suggested to the IOC that they stagger the Winter and Summer Olympics. Next stop, college football. Dennis convinced the Rose Bowl to throw in with the Orange, Sugar, and Fiesta Bowls to create the BCS College Football Championship. Dennis also ran ABC Daytime. He wanted some fresh faces on the soaps. He liked Kelly Ripa on the All My Children casting reel. And he ran the children's division at the same time, where he gave a second life to Scooby-Doo. Swanson went back to NBC and turned the Christmas tree lighting at Rockefeller Center into a national telecast. Fox then beckoned as he joined with Roger Ailes, Jack Abernathy, and Frank Sicha to help Warner Brothers launch TMZ, now a hit show in syndication. No wonder so many say,
"There's no individual more responsible for the success of the People's Court than you, Dennis."
Everyone at King World owes you a great deal.
And I wanted to say, loud enough for the whole world to hear, Dennis, I thank you.
Well, for you people that didn't grow up in Illinois, that's Chicago, playing Get Feeling Stronger Today, which was my pick for the music. To get an award from Dick Ebersol as your presenter and to have it be a Tartikoff Award is pretty
pretty good for a kid from downstate Illinois. Wow, thank you very much. Very special. You know, Dick and I were competitors and have become good friends, and for him to come all the way down here to Miami is very special to me. Brandon, as we've all heard, I mean, how many, there'll be nobody ever create that many network hits again, I can't imagine. Very special, and to get an award in his name is very special. Lily, thank you for those remarks. We did work together in the late 90s, and she's done so much to help so many people. That walk, which still goes on, was great, and it was great to work with her. A couple other people I would thank are my two bosses. They're both here, Jack Abernathy, who runs the Fox Station division, and my wife, Kathy. We just celebrated our 50th wedding anniversary on December the 16th. And the reality is, I don't think I would have gotten nearly as far ahead in this business if I hadn't had a great partner who has been with me every step of the way. And then, you know, it pays to be lucky, and I've been lucky. You know, when I was in the ABC station division, you know, we had a structure for programming. We actually had program departments. We had program director. We had assistant program director. We had an executive producer. We had crews. You know, we had talent. We actually had scheduled programs in our regular lineup. And so, when I get to Chicago, all that exists. And yes, we hired Oprah. That turned out. I always thought she was going to be great. We'd done an audition with her, which was the best I ever saw. But as I say, there was a structure to put her into. And then when we go on to New York, it was the same thing. There's Regis. Fortunately, I was president of the division then, so I could override the GM who was going to hire the wrong woman, I thought. So, we hired Kathy Lee, and that turned out to be pretty good. And even later on, when I was at WNBC, there was still a program department. And, I remember Adele Rifkin was the program director. You know, she's gone now, but she came to me and said, "What do you want to do with the Christmas tree lighting?" I said, "What do you mean, what I want to do with it?" She said, "Well, it's just a tape delay thing." And I said, "Well, no, let's make a program out of it." And it actually, we made an hour, it was syndicated. It went into syndication. It did so well, the network said, "Wow, maybe we should put that on." So we went to a two-hour format. But I think it would be hard for somebody to have those opportunities today, because there were things in place that you could manage and develop things, and a lot of those don't exist anymore. So I consider myself very, very fortunate that when I came along, first of all, there was television. Well, it's been great. It's been great for a lot of people in this room, and that there were mechanisms in place that I could work with to create what we did. So in the interest of time, I guess I'm on for half an hour tomorrow morning. I'll save some of the stuff for that. At any rate, again, thank you to everybody. My congratulations to the other three award winners. They all have done incredible things in their own situations, and I appreciate getting this award from that carries Brandon Tartikoff's name. I treasure it. Thank you.
He also gave me my first job, so thank you at WNBC. Yeah, I'm a footnote. It's okay. Later on, you'll get up there with Oprah, whoever that is, and Regis. But he did. I had a cockamamie idea to be able to do these little lifestyle pieces around, and even let it go on the early morning news. And it worked. From there, it went to Access Hollywood, and I grew. So, Dennis, include me in your next speech. Now the CEO of one of the world's largest international creators and producers and distributors of leading television programming. Everybody knows Fremantle Media. They've got some of the biggest shows on TV. Please welcome Tony Cohen.
Thank you. thank you very much. I had to interview Cecile Frot-Coutaz for a job one sunny morning in London 16 years ago. My boss at the time, Greg Dyke, had to decide whether to hire this young French woman from the strategy department of Pearson Group. Is she smart enough, he said? Is she tough enough for television? I had a coffee with her to check her out. And afterwards, I rang Greg and I said, you know, I'm not really worried about her being smart and tough enough. I'm not sure you're smart and tough enough for her. In fact, she was and is a most brilliant appointment. From the time she ran our Southern European companies, a tough gig, if there ever was one, to what she's been doing for the last 7 years, which is running our company in North America. And under her leadership, Fremantle Media North America is now the most successful and the biggest company in the Fremantle Group. And as CEO, she has to deal with the big talent, the big partners like Simon Cowell and Simon Fuller. And she oversees all those big shows for us. American Idol, number one series for 8 years. America's Got Talent, number one entertainment on NBC for the last 4 years. The X Factor on Fox. It's the most successful autumn series launch for 5 years. The Price is Right. It's the top-rated entertainment show in daytime in the US in 2011. And Let's Make a Deal, both of them on CBS. And let's not forget Family Feud, on air for 11 glorious years and strong as it's ever been, stronger, in fact. But what Cecile has brought to all the things that she's done at Fremantle, it's been common to all of them. Brave thinking, brave decisions, huge passion, an absolutely extraordinary loyalty and dedication to her team, to her colleagues, to her partners, and to her work. Let's see what some of her colleagues have to say about Cecile. Could you roll the tape, please, as we used to say? Cecile is passionate, she's focused, and she has something that's really rare in television executives, is that she can be both a creative person and a commercial person in equal measure. It's a very unusual mix. Every night, tens of millions of Americans watch the shows that she's responsible for. It's a fantastic achievement.
I was once asked to outline what I thought was the leader of tomorrow, and I wrote, I've met her. She's small and French. That's a seal.
She's a pretty tough and determined lady when she puts her mind to it. She's in the land of egos and elbows, where there's a lot of very strong-willed men who want things their way.
I've never seen someone walk into a room and just command it with this presence of power and beauty and elegance all at the same time. So, Cecile, she's awesome.
A strong, powerful woman who's not afraid to say what she thinks and to do what she needs to do, no matter what. She don't take no nothing from nobody, and I like that.
I was very attracted to her. But again, you know, she's very smart, which brings the attraction even closer. You know, then I asked her if she was married. She said she was, and it was cut right off right there. That was the end of it.
I gotta give it to her, man. I gotta give her mad props. I mean, without her, I don't know if any of this would have been possible.
Cecile, you are like a mother to us. Well, an older sister. We just want to say congratulations on your Legacy Award.
Can I describe Cecile? What happens if you merge a kitten and a shark? If they ever had a baby, it would be Cecile. She's kind of cute, but then she bites you.
Cecile, congratulations on your award. You so deserve it.
The
the Brandon Tartikoff Legacy Award. Well, I think her legs are much nicer than Brandon's ever were.
If I had to sum it up in a phrase, she has the X factor.
I adore you and you deserve this. Congratulations.
My warmest congratulations for the 2012 Brandon Tartikoff Legacy Award from all of us within RTL Group and Bertelsmann. We are tremendously proud that you are one of us. And don't be too modest tonight. You really deserve this award like nobody else does.
So, as Gerhard said there, we're all, she really deserves this. We are, all of us, I and all my colleagues at Fremantle Media, enormously proud of what Cecile has achieved. And it gives me really great pleasure to present the Brandon Tartikoff Legacy Award to that extraordinary mixture of shark and kitten.
I don't think I'm ever going to recover from that. That's it. Thank you, Tony, and thank you to NATPE for the wonderful honor of this Legacy Award. And it's a pleasure to be in such great company tonight. Well, legacy is a really imposing word. It brings to mind ancestors and things of great importance handed down through generations. And ultimately, it summarizes what we all aspire to do in life. Which is to leave something behind by which we'll be remembered. And it carries even more weight when it is associated with Brandon Tartikoff, who more than anyone has left a fantastic legacy on this business. When you look at what we do, all of us in this room tonight, it's true that we endeavor to create memorable content that will stand the test of time. And we do that as best we can, and with as much creativity as we can muster, along with hard work, hope, and quite a lot of luck. And tonight, I want to take this time to celebrate the classic brands of television, otherwise known as the old shows. And you know, in a world today which is dominated by the new, you know, we focus on new launches and, you know, new genres and new plot twists and, you know, new talent. And we live in a culture that is all about youth. It's all about technology and the effect of technology on television as a whole. It's important to remember that those classic shows are still thriving and doing incredibly well. And I guess in some ways, it's why I'm here tonight. In a world where we're battling fragmentation and we're trying to continue to capture the attention of this 18 to 34 demo that is so fickle, when you look at franchises like Survivor, The Bachelor, Big Brother, Idol, The Price is Right, and so on and so forth, and you look at what they're still doing, it's a tremendous credit to what these shows have accomplished. When Bob Barker left The Price is Right, everyone thought it was time to pack up the tent and the show was basically over. You know, it was gonna put away the Plinko game and put the big wheel into the mothballs, and you know, and that was it. And we were fortunate that, you know, Drew Carey agreed to come on board, and you know, and he surpassed everybody's expectations. And in a similar way, you know, when Simon left American Idol, you know, again, it was kind of game over. And you know, people sort of, you know, had pretty much could have given up on the show. And what we found is, you know, the audiences fell in love with the new judges in the same way as they fell in love with Steve Harvey when he joined Family Feud a couple of years ago, and when Brady on Let's Make a Deal, and you know, and the next one for us is Howard Stern joining America's Got Talent. And you know, we're really excited to see what he's going to bring to that franchise and how he spices it up. And I think at the end of the day, you know, what I sort of want to leave everybody with tonight is, when you look at these formats that can still entertain audiences today and hold their own, I think that's good news. It's good news for us, the producers. It's good news for the networks. It's good news for the business. You know, this is a business where, you know, 10 years ago, you know, if you'd listened to the dot-com, you know, the people in the dot-com years, it was, you know, we would have been dead today. The business, it was over. You know, TV was gone. And, you know, when you look at the work that, you know, we did on Feud, Price is Right, Idol, we're doing now on Got Talent, and the work that Warner Brothers and CBS and Short Lori did earlier this year on Two and a Half Men, you know, what it really shows is that in the end, the format is bigger than any individual star. And you know what that means? It means that good producing eventually pays off. And that's good news. It's really good news for us. Of course, you know, this work isn't done by one single person. It's the accomplishment of teams of tireless, you know, writers, producers, directors, editors. And, you know, of course, I, you know, I share this award tonight with, you know, Tony, who's been incredibly supportive, the team at Fremantle, our great producers, you know, people like Ken Warwick, Nigel Lithgow, Charles Boyd, the producers on, you know, on the daily game shows, and our partners, you know, at the networks. And you need everybody to be on the same page to achieve that. And then finally, you know, I, this wouldn't be complete if, you know, I didn't give a special thanks to both Simons, both Mr. Fuller and you know, Simon Fuller and Simon Cowell, who had the vision to launch Pop Idol in the UK 12 years ago. And they had an enormous influence on my career and my life. You know, I think I worked, they made me work a lot harder than I ever thought I would. But I wouldn't be here today if it weren't for their passion and their friendship. And then finally, thank you to all of you here tonight, you know, with whom we work and maybe even compete. You make our jobs, you know, incredibly exciting, and, you know, competition keeps everybody on their toes, so that's a good thing. And, you know, I want to say congratulations to my fellow honorees, and thank you very much, and enjoy the rest of the evening.
Just watching that video, I don't think she gets enough credit for ego management. Unbelievable. A kitten and a shark. Oh, my God. Anyway, now it's an honor to introduce a true Renaissance man who describes himself as a hunter who works as a writer, an author, director, and producer. His script for 21 Grams received a BAFTA nomination for Best Screenplay. Please welcome Guillermo Arriaga.
Hello, I'm here to introduce Fernando Gaitán from Colombia. And he's the first recipient of this award from Latin America. So I'm very proud as a Mexican, I'm Mexican, that someone from Latin America received this award. And I want to tell you some things about Fernando that little people know about him. First about his work, then his private life. Which I know something about it. Fernando is the writer of Ugly Betty, Betty La Fea, and has 22 versions of it around the world. The American version won 2 Golden Globes and an Emmy, and the rest of the versions have won hundreds of awards. There's something interesting here in Miami. People in Miami will like this story. Fidel Castro, you know Fidel Castro? He used to have very long speeches. Well, because of the success in Cuba of Café con Aroma de Mujer, Coffee with the Scent of a Woman, a telenovela, Fidel Castro shortened his speeches in order that the Cubans can go and see the telenovela. So Fernando Gaitán is the only one who can be able to cut. I don't know if that will happen also with Chavez in Venezuela. Certainly it will. He has the Guinness record for the most seen telenovela in the history of television. He has the highest rating of telenovelas in Mexico, where I come from, who is the Hollywood of telenovelas. We want to change that soap opera thing and look for another name for it. Maybe telenovelas will be the right one. Or maybe the creation of Fernando Gaitán, because he's someone by his own. Fernando only reached to high school. He has no college or university. Why? Because he became the father of beautiful Luisa, who's today's birthday. So he had to work. And he began first as a journalist. Journalism became a very important part of his work. He loves to research. I don't know why I hate researching, but he loves to research. And 31 years old, because he had to sustain his family, he began working on TV. And since then, he became an unstoppable force of nature. I don't want these achievements to overshadow the great human being he is. He's very generous, he's warm, he's very funny. And he's so generous that he allows me to stay at his place several times in Bogota. And I write only for films. I spent around 3 to 4 years writing a screenplay. This man writes himself, because he doesn't have a team of writers, between 5,000 and 8,000 pages of television scripts per year. Not only that, this man loves partying. He owns several nightclubs in Bogota. He's known to be the king of the nightclubs. I have seen him, this is truth, arrive home every day at 4 in the morning, and then at 6, wake up and go and write these 5,000 pages a year. I don't know how he can do it. I write one paragraph per night. He writes one telenovela per night. So Fernando really, I don't understand how he can be this strong man he is. And we cannot hide talent. And I'm very, very happy that coming from Latin America, you cannot hide the huge talent that Fernando has, and I'm proud to present. And now I have seen some analogies for animals for the previous. You know? Cecile, a kitten, and a shark. Dennis, a bear. Okay. I've been looking for an animal for Mr. Fernando Gaitán. That will be a tiger. Not because he's fierce, because he makes love every 20 minutes. Of course, he's Latin American. You remember the word Latin lover? So please roll the video.
What is the soul made of? Perhaps of little bites that life gives to all the things that cross our paths from the moment we're born. Every toy, every book, every comic, every song, every movie, and every TV series are the magic food for the spirit. And still, what is the soul made of? Perhaps of all the laughter and tears we've had, or maybe of the combination of our dreams and deceptions, of our successes and our failures. Blessed be the good. Blessed be the bad. Because that's what makes you who you are. Thank you.
Lo que más me emociona de este premio es que no solamente un reconocimiento a mi trabajo, sino un reconocimiento a la televisión que hacemos en RCN y un reconocimiento a la televisión que hacemos desde Colombia para el mundo.
The Tiger himself. No entiendo inglés.
I don't understand English.
No sé qué dijo Arriaga de mí.
I have no idea what Arriaga said about me.
Ojalá sea en parte cierto lo que dijo.
I'm not sure if there was anything partly true of what he said.
No estoy seguro de haberlo invitado ya.
I'm not sure why I invited him.
Gracias, Guillermo.
That's Guillermo.
Para mí es muy importante estar acá, más que tal vez ninguno de los otros homenajeados que han merecido este premio.
Tonight is particularly important for me to be here tonight, a little bit more than the other award winners.
Vengo de producir televisión desde hace de muchos kilómetros distantes de Estados Unidos.
Television from many kilometers away, very far away from the United States.
Ha sido una televisión que hemos venido trabajando con muchísimo esfuerzo.
Making television that has been hardworking and with a lot of effort trying to produce it.
Todos en Colombia, como en muchas partes del mundo, pues tenemos grandes influencias de la televisión norteamericana.
In Colombia, like many other countries in the world, we are very influenced by the American television.
Y todos siempre soñamos en algún momento en haber llegado a la televisión norteamericana.
And we all dream sometime in our life and in our work to reach the United States television.
Pero eso siempre pareció imposible. Por eso estoy tan contento de estar aquí en este lugar recibiendo este premio.
But that always seems like an impossible dream, so that's why I'm particularly happy and ecstatic about being here tonight.
Nosotros en Colombia seguimos la televisión norteamericana y la admiramos.
In Colombia, we follow the American television and we admire it.
Pero en algún momento entendimos que no podíamos hacer una televisión similar.
But we understood that we couldn't do exactly the same type of television for our market.
Las condiciones en que hacíamos televisión, en que se inició nuestra televisión, son muy distintas a las condiciones en que se inició la televisión americana.
The conditions in which we would produce television for our countries is very different from the conditions with Americans produce.
Nosotros en algunos momentos, algunas veces quisimos imitar la televisión norteamericana y fue un fracaso.
Sometimes we actually did try to imitate the American television the way they did it, but it was a failure.
Nuestros marcianos no eran tan buenos como los de acá.
Our Martians weren't as good as the ones in the States.
Si queremos hacer el submarino jamás volvió a flote.
¿Qué?
El submarino nunca volvió a flote.
The submarine never came up to surface.
Es muy difícil para nosotros en esa época competir con una televisión tan elaborada y tan tecnológica y con tanto dinero de por medio.
It was very difficult to compete with a television that had so much technology and budget to help it get produced. We didn't have those resources.
Por eso para nosotros fue tan importante y ha sido tan importante el género de la telenovela.
That's why the telenovela was such an important category for us.
La telenovela ha sido un vehículo cultural de Latinoamérica tan importante y tan hermano como el bolero, el tango, la samba, el bossa nova.
The telenovela has been
hermano.
Empieza de nuevo. No, the telenovela has been a genre as important to Latin America as the bolero, the tango, the bossa nova.
Y ha sido una forma en que como nos hemos comunicado con el mundo, ha sido una forma en que hemos llevado nuestras realidades hasta a muchos países del mundo.
And it has been our way of communicating with the rest of the world.
Sin embargo, ha sido un género que hemos podido ir evolucionando poco a poco en toda Latinoamérica.
But it has been a genre that has been developing and evolving throughout Latin America.
Durante los últimos años, ha sido un género que ha ido incorporando elementos de otras televisiones del mundo, desde la mexicana, la argentina, la brasilera, hasta la norteamericana.
During the last few years, it has been a genre that has been incorporating different attributes from different types of television internationally, including Mexican and American.
Así es como después de muchos años en que estuvimos muy distantes del mercado norteamericano, salvo a través de los canales latinoamericanos, hemos podido regresar de nuevo a la televisión latinoamericana, a la televisión norteamericana.
So after many years of from being away and staying away from the American television, we have come back throughout time to imitate, not to imitate, but to be related to American television.
Sin embargo, nosotros, por ejemplo, a través de géneros como el stand-up comedy, géneros como el sitcom, hemos logrado hacer cosas como Betty la Fea.
So through genres like the sitcom, like Betty la Fea, we have...
Hemos logrado llegar aquí al premio norteamericano.
We have been able to reach American audiences.
Y hemos llegado también a muchos países del mundo a través de este mismo género.
We have been able to reach many other countries in the world throughout this same genre.
Así que lo que parecía tan distante para nosotros durante muchos años,
so what seemed so far away for us for many years,
hoy para nosotros es la realización de un sueño poder estar aquí con ustedes.
Today is a dream come true to be able to be with you here sharing tonight.
Que un premio tan prestigioso reconozca un trabajo que se hace desde Latinoamérica.
That an award has been recognized, such a prestigious award is recognized from a work done in Latin America.
Porque considero que no es solamente un premio para mí y para Colombia, sino para toda la televisión latinoamericana.
I consider this an award not only for me in Colombia, but for the rest of Latin America.
Aquí hay muchas de las personas a las que debo mis triunfos.
Here there are many people present who I owe my success.
Mi presidente, Gabriel Reyes, de RCN Televisión.
Gabriel Reyes, the RCN president.
Samuel Duque, de Fox Televisión, Fox Telecolombia. Samuel Duque.
Samuel Duque.
Muy bien.
From
de Fox Telecolombia, ¿cierto?
From Fox.
Okay. Antonio, José Antonio de Brigard y su combo de Teleset Sony.
José Antonio Brigard and from Sony.
Jaime Sánchez y la gente de Vista y Disney, que nos los veo por acá hoy. Mi familia,
my family,
Ana María, mi hija Luisa Fernanda, que está cumpliendo años hoy.
Her birthday tonight.
Guillermo, no.
Not Guillermo.
agradezco muchísimo, de verdad, y este es un paso muy importante para la carrera mía y para la carrera de la televisión y para RCN Televisión.
Thank you very much. This is a very important step for me and for the television career and for RCN in Colombia. Thank you very much.
Ahora venimos con un trabajo. Gracias.
¿No? ¿Nada más?
Thank you.
Wish I had a hot translator. Anyway. Hey, I'm going out to dinner tonight at Prime 112 with my agent, Fernando, but I can lose him after him. I mean, let's go. I'm ready. I'm sure you own one of those boats out there in the bay. Let's get on it. Have some fun. oh, God. Compose. Another creative visionary who, in addition to having assembled an impressive roster of primetime programming, heads an award-winning feature-length documentary unit, the president of Lionsgate Television Group, who also, he would like you to know, makes love every 15 minutes. Please welcome Kevin Bex.
Thank you, Billy. Matthew Weiner, is quite simply one of the most gifted storytellers of our time, who has indelibly changed the face of television with his breakthrough drama, Mad Men. He is a brilliant artist who has created a world rich with color and rife with conflict that illuminates the human condition, a consummate showman who values the intelligence of the audience and works tirelessly to entertain and surprise them, a master craftsman who cares passionately about the integrity of every frame of film, a visionary who inspires critics, bloggers, and even the academic community to dissect and analyze nearly every aspect of the show. Brandon Tartikoff loved television. He obsessed over television. He elevated television. If there is anyone I have ever met or worked with who loves, obsesses, and desires to elevate television with as much passion, it is Matthew Weiner. The result is a series that will leave its mark for generations to come. But don't just take my word for it. Matthew's fellow Mad Men producers have produced something special with which to honor him tonight. Let's see it.
Who is Matt Weiner?
Matt Weiner?
Matt's the man with all the right answers.
Matt.
Who is Andy Griffith?
Correct.
Who is Schwarzkopf? Who is Moses?
Correct.
Matt Weiner created Mad Men. And working with him has been amazing.
The only good thing about not working with Matt Weiner anymore is now I get to be a Matt Weiner fan like everybody else.
Matt, to me, is a true artist and a true friend, and I'm grateful for the day that I met him.
Matt is probably the funniest drama writer I know and the comedy writer with the greatest sense of the human experience.
Matt is very big on secrecy, doesn't like to let any details get out.
That's why he makes us sign this non-disclosure agreement.
Yeah, but what's the worst thing that's going to happen? What's he going to do if we let something go? Like, if I were to let slip that the big discovery at the end of season five is when Don says...
Come on, you made me sign an NDA for my own show.
People often wonder what is Matt's creative process.
Lots of fresh water. On my... balls.
I think back to your early days on Mad Men when you were obsessing over how large the apples were. It's that attention to detail that stuck with me. And to that end, I want to make sure that the meth we use on Breaking Bad is down, you know, to the hundredth of a gram weight-wise. So I always weigh all the props myself. This is the fake stuff, by the way. This is the real stuff.
Prior to you, I wasn't watching much television. Mad Men really opened my eyes as to what was possible. I guess I owe you my new interest in television. You are my inspiration, Matt.
And now he's being honored with the Brandon Tartikoff Legacy Award.
No idea what the Brandon Tartikoff Award is.
Legacy? Was the show been on for 5 years?
But whatever it is, I'm sure you deserve it.
On behalf of everyone at AMC, we are so proud of you. Congratulations on this award, and thank you for your great work and collaboration for the last 5 years, and here's to many more.
Brandon Tartikoff always strives for excellence. Matt, he would have been very impressed with your unique vision and your dedication to perfection. Congratulations from all of your friends at Lionsgate.
Fuck you, Matt, and your awards and your accolades and all your business. It just takes time away from me.
Congratulations, Matt. I know in these types of situations you're quite humble and like to say that you're not deserving, and in this case you're probably right.
Matt, congratulations on the Brandon Tartikoff Legacy Award. You deserve it. You deserve it all. We love you.
Who is this for?
Oh, congratulations, Matthew.
We love you, Matt.
Congratulations.
Congratulations, Matt.
Congratulations, Matt.
Congratulations, pal.
Hey, Matt, thanks for doing Mad Men. You set AMC and our entire company on a different course. We are truly grateful. It's been a wonderful ride. Congratulations. Dear world, we get it. You like giving Matt awards. Enjoy it. Take your Legacy Award and your 100 Emmys, put them all over your head. Still not going to be this.
On behalf of NATPE, it's my pleasure to present the Brandon Tartikoff Legacy Award to my friend, Matthew Weiner. Congratulations.
Wow, that was my whole life flashing before my eyes. I have prepared remarks. I had a little time on the trip over here. I'm not talking about the flight, I'm talking about the elevator. But I don't know that they really apply anymore. I want to say thank you, first of all, to Lily and to NATPE. Is it NATPE? NATPE? I can't be the only person who has this problem. To all of you for including me in this group of people here tonight, and also to say thank you to Lionsgate, to Kevin. That was really amazing. I can't believe people went to all that trouble on my set without my knowledge. And also must have involved the most important person in my life, my wife Linda, to get all that dirt on me. But I want to thank Lionsgate, John Feldheimer and Kevin and Sandra and AMC, Josh, who you saw there, and Charlie, of course, for taking a risk on the show and for letting me do this, because my relationship with Brandon Tartikoff is very simple. I never met him, but I, revealing my age here, I guess everybody knows how old I am anyway, but... I went to college, let's put it this way. I was not allowed to watch TV growing up. It was forbidden in my home, not because my parents had anything against TV, but because I was a horrible student, and the first thing that was taken away when my grades were bad was television. So I was allowed to watch on Friday night and Saturday night, and not on school nights, and that really limited things. And thank God, eventually my grades were good enough that I got to go to college and spend 4 years watching TV. That is my relationship with Brandon Tartikoff, is that he was, whether he realizes it or not, I was his demo. I went to school in Middletown, Connecticut. There were signal issues, antenna, foil, and so forth, and I remember saying, I don't care where the apartment is. We were looking for an apartment, my girlfriend and me at the time, I don't care where it is. All I need to know is that it gets Channel 4. That's all I cared about. And to sit here and to then eventually end up in the TV business, something that was doled out to me in such small doses and so important to me, and something which I never felt was a second-class form of entertainment. To me, it was the same thing as the movies. It was something so important to me where I could... I don't know if I'm more active when I watch it, but I never just zoned out and let something wash over me. And I liked the different kinds of the different genres. And eventually, when I got married and I was out of work after film school, I discovered ALF, because it was on right before the Laker game. And I remember when I was looking through the list of Brandon's legacy, which is really what we're here about, I was just like, this guy, like, literally, I am looking at someone who is programming for me. Every single show, there's nothing embarrassing on there. I know that we're sitting here in the midst of a bunch of very successful people, and you're only judged by your successes, and I'm sure there were lots of failures and lots of dark times, but it's just really an expression of respect for the audience and something that I feel personally attached to when I look at his career, which is that I believe that statement. I actually didn't know that he'd said that about telling the audience, showing the audience what they want. And it doesn't mean that you think they're stupid. It's just that part of entertainment is a surprise. And there is this mystery that human beings crave, they demand novelty. And they also crave routine. And you're stuck in this thing where you're either going to be chasing a trend or just behind it, or how do I have the next big thing? And you're looking at somebody... When you look at that resume and the resumes of the people here tonight who really are doing what I've been allowed to do and what I think the people who make the show are allowed to do, and I'm specifically talking about the risk involved from Lionsgate and AMC in embarking on something like this, because it's not, it should have been cheaper for how risky it was, which is to make something that you want to see. And there's lots of different things for people to see, but I just think about how much television has changed. I do this show about the history of, you know, of America, and I got to read a lot about the transition from radio into television and how quickly radio disappeared and what television became and what television meant and visual storytelling and that it wasn't movies. All these things had to be discovered, and the formation of the networks and the way the advertising agencies were involved in creating all the shows. And we all know there's a million different jobs, some of them created by some of the people in this room that no one even knew, like how or who was going to be in charge of deciding what it is. But in the end, the content is the thing that ends up on the air. And whatever television becomes, we're watching all the entertainment in our house. I'm sure everybody's talking to you guys about this all week. We're watching everything in our house, whether it's Avatar or Mad Men or Price is Right. Some of our screens are very, very small, and some of them are as big as the movie theaters that we used to go to. And I just think that I'm proud that we're in a moment where there's room for different kinds of things from different countries. And I also am proud that I got to turn my hidden vice, my guilty pleasure, television into a way of life. And the idea that I'm here with these list of people with these accomplishments is astounding to me, but I wanted people to be entertained, and if what I'm doing is giving you pleasure, then if you get good grades and you do all of your homework, and I want to see it, you can come downstairs at 9 o'clock and 10 o'clock, and you can watch the show. Thank you very much. I'm very honored.
Okay. Well, we've honored a bear, a tiger, a shark kitten. I need an animal for you, Matt. I don't know, a phoenix, a great rising phoenix. Congratulations to all the honorees. Lily, thank you for a great night, and it's wonderful to be here under the umbrella of Brandon Tartikoff, who, by the way, had the idea for Access Hollywood, too, and I have that job thanks to his vision there. Folks, have a great night. Fernando, see you at the curb in 5.